Assalamu alaikum and welcome to part 2 on Jibreel, not an angel, being not an angel. And now we're going to discuss Jibreel and Moses and the children of Israel's trial. Jibreel has manifested himself in so many different ways in the life of the children of Israel. His appearance changed the course of history for those people. I have spoken a lot about them in my talks about Ashura. Please head to my YouTube channel, Islam Pep Talk, and you will find more about that talk in there. But in more simplistic ways, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Musa to Egypt to take the children of Israel out of Egypt, and after so many years, so many decades, finally Musa succeeded in taking the children of Israel. You know the story, it's in Al-Quran. Now, Musa alayhi salam was supposed to lead his people to the blessed land, and the blessed land, Al-Ard al-Mubarakah, is Palestine, what's known today as Palestine, Syria, Lebanon, and Jordan. So that's all this land is what Allah has blessed. He has blessed Palestine specifically and all the lands surrounding it. But the children of Israel were promised Palestine as long as they did few things. One of them is they should fight for it. The children of Israel were not strong and were not courageous enough to fight for that land. And so many stories, both in the Bible and in the Quran, where they chickened out and they didn't want to fight for the lands. And Musa was angry with them. At one point they said to Musa, "Go with your God and fight. We are here waiting you," i.e. bring us the keys to the city. And of course Musa was got very angry with them, and that's when he supplicated to Allah that he should separate him from the children of Israel. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala caused the children of Israel to err in the desert, and that say for 40 years until the old generation died and the new ones were rough and tough and everything. And it is this new generation that were courageous, or they had a lot of courage, and they fought and they invaded Palestine and they took it and everything, and Allah blessed the land for them. So that's what happened back then. But the conditions were that the children of Israel must observe the commands that Allah had sent to them, namely the 10 commandments, which also exist in the Quran. Okay, and for us to execute as well. A long story short, on their way to the Valley of Tuwa, which is today a big mountain, and the whole Sinai Valley, so to speak, it's a big chunk of land. Musa, on his way to meet with Allah, Allah commanded Musa to fast 30 days. When Musa fasted 30 days, Allah added another 10, that is 40 days and 40 nights that Musa should fast before going to meet Allah one more time. And on his way to meeting Allah, his people were with him. It was the deal that Musa should go with his people to meet Allah, then his people should stop at one point and Musa should carry on. But Musa did one thing that Allah did not command him to do. Musa alayhi salam wanted to speed up his steps and be there at the place of meeting with Allah way before his people got there. And that didn't register well with Allah, because when Allah orders you something, you must carry it to the letter. Don't try to make it better than what Allah has commanded you to do. And that was the mistake that Moses made at that time. When he got to the place of appointment with Allah, Allah honored the meeting and Allah spoke to Musa. Now, the speaking of Allah to Musa is Allah spoke to Musa. The how and all these things, I'll deal with it later on, inshallah. Allah asks a particular question to Musa. He told him, وَمَا أَعْجَلَكَ عَنْ قَوْمِكَ يَا مُوسَى, and what has made you come ahead of your people in such a haste, Moses? You see, my sisters and my brothers, you have to pay attention. If Allah knew as to the reason why Musa came and Allah asked Musa a question, then Allah is making fun of Musa, because if you know the answer, why would he ask? And this is why I told you before that Allah has chosen not to know the future. Allah knows the unseen, and the unseen exists now for Allah to know it and see it. But what is going to happen, whatever, Allah has chosen not to know it so that He does not interfere with our choices. And that's why there is Judgment Day to hold us responsible for our deeds. Anyhow, Musa says, قال هم أولئي على أثري. He goes, my God, my Lord, well, here they are just behind me, close upon my tracks. They are not very far. وعجلت إليك ربي لترضى. And I hastened to you, my Lord, so that you be pleased with me. So Musa wanted to please Allah, but he did something that Allah didn't tell him to do. And pleasing Allah is by doing what He wants you to do. Don't invent things out of your head and then do them and think, oh, I'm gonna please Allah. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells Musa, قال فَإِنَّا قَدْ فَتَنَّا قَوْمَكَ مِنْ بَعْدِكَ. Well, after you left your people, we have put your people through a hard test. وَأَضَلَّهُمُ السَّامِرِي. And السَّامِرِي, a name of a man, has led them astray. Subhanallah. السَّامِرِي has done them wrong and turned them away from the right path of believing in one God to committing their worship to a statue. And as a result to that, the children of Israel, the great number of them, committed shirk. And shirk is to take someone else as partner in what Allah alone is entitled to. So, at which point Moses realized his doing and how his leadership absence helped the children of Israel go wrong, and how he had done wrong towards Allah by inventing things out of himself, i.e. going far and going faster than what Allah had commanded him to do, and how that misjudgment has caused a lot of problems. When he heard that, Allah gave him the Torah, in tablets. And then Musa held the tablets and went back to the children of Israel. فَرَجْعَ مُوسَى إِلَىٰ قَوْمِهِ غَضْبَانَ أَسِفًا. So Moses returned to his people furious and full of remorse for what he has done. The story goes on, and you can read about it in Surah 20. That is Surah number 20. That is Taha. The whole Surah speaks about the children of Israel's exodus. The book of Exodus is also the second book in the Bible of the Old Testament, and describes the exodus, which includes the children of Israel's deliverance from tyranny and oppression in Egypt to the promised land. And again, it tells us the whole story. Some claim it and some deny it, i.e. that Palestine is for the children of Israel. Others say no, it's not for the children of Israel. Others say, but because of politics today, we cannot say that the children of Israel, the Jewish of today, have a right to it. And indeed, by the text of the Quran, they have a right to it. It's our politics throughout the centuries of past that has done wrong to the children of Israel and chased them and took their rights from them, rights that Allah has given them. And that's why they went back to there to Palestine, killing and doing all that kind of stuff. It's because of all these things. Today, my dear sisters and my brothers, even though the Quran says something, but because of politics' sake, we do not accept what the Jews are doing. Yes, killing all that stuff is wrong. But why are they killing? It's because we took something that Allah had promised them before. Yes, they failed, they, but they are entitled to live in Palestine in full peace and full harmony and everything. But again, as I said, it's politics for us, and that's why we are paying the price today of what has happened before. Anyway, back to Musa alayhi salam. When Musa returned, as soon as he saw the children of Israel worshiping the calf, he got very angry. And what did he do? He was so angry that he lost control and threw the tablets upon which Allah has written parts of the Torah on those tablets. And then he returns to his people very angry, furious, in fact, and in full remorse for allowing this to take place. And for As-Samiri to do his bidding, so many things had happened. You see, for the children of Israel to associate, to take others, or to worship the calf, it was a doing very wrong. Because of all people, they saw directly what Allah could do. Isn't Allah that took them out of Palestine? Of Egypt? Isn't Allah that drowned Fir'aun right in front of their very own eyes? Isn't it Allah that split the sea not in two parts? He split it in two parts, and then he had around 12 pathways for the different tribes of Israel to walk through the land. And then when the children of Israel had crossed to the other land and in safety, and they saw how Fir'aun drowned, and they should be thankful to Allah, correct? Well, as they walked a little bit, they found a people that had a god. And they were worshipping this. And then they said to Musa, why don't you give us a deity, some statue to worship, just like these people have? Listen to what Allah says about this. It's kind of like the old habits die hard, and it's true. قالوا يا موسى, they said, Moses, اجعل لنا إلها كما لهم آلهة, make for us a god just as they have gods. The children of Israel grew in Egypt, and the Egyptians always prayed to some kind of statue, and that's how they manifested the god. So Allah, the children of Israel asked Musa, okay, to sculpt something for them, and then Musa is going to tell them, okay, this rock or this statue here is Allah. Worship him, you are worshiping Allah. That's what they wanted, something to manifest, to do that, to have something kind of like tangible they can see to pray to. And then they said to him, فَأَتَوْ عَلَىٰ قَوْمٍ. Then Allah says, when they came upon a people who dedicated their worship to their idols, يَعْكُفُونَ عَلَىٰ أَصْنَامِ اللَّهِ, قَالُوا يَا مُوسَىٰ, they said, Moses, make for us a god, just they have gods. قَالَ إِنَّكُمْ قَوْمٌ تَجْهَلُونَ, he said, you are indeed trespassers, i.e. people who trespass the command of Allah just to make him one god. Now, Musa alayhi salam, when he got to his people, he had to come confront somebody else, As-Samiri. And the reason this took place is because it's extremely dangerous. And this is where Jibril alayhi salam comes into play. You see, when Musa got to his people, or before Musa leaving to meet Allah, he had left his brother Harun as a leader. And he told him not to do anything that would separate the children of Israel. So Musa alayhi salam, when he came back and he was angry, the first one he went to is his brother Harun. And he was angry at him and he told him, why didn't you do what I told you to take care of the children of Israel? And what has happened? The long story short, Harun apologized and everything. Then Musa went to As-Samiri to find out exactly how his departure and why the majority of the children of Israel had worshipped the calf built by this man, As-Samiri, and why he has done what he has done. Allah had already informed Musa what the children of Israel had done. And Allah had given the name of the perpetrator, so it was not a matter of knowing who did it. Musa knew exactly who did it. Allah says that As-Samiri was the guy who did it. So that's that. Okay. Allah tells us this in the Quran. It tells us, وَاتَّخَذَ قَوْمُ مُوسَى مِنْ بَعْدِهِ, and in the absence of Moses, his people undertook for themselves, من حليهم عجلا جسدا له خوار, they took from their jewelry an idol of a calf that made a loin golden. So basically what it says this is that they had sculpted this calf, the baby of a cow and the male, and then that calf was making exactly the sound of cattle, of cows mowing and all that kind of stuff. And this is absolutely incredible. And that calf was made from the gold and silver and all the jewelry that the children of Israel stole from the Egyptian people. Okay? So that's the price. They stole it. It became the source of their misery. And that's why if someone steals money, steals whatever they steal, what they steal from people, it always turns up a source of their misery. Okay, when Musa went to them and asked them, why did you do that and why did you do this? They said to him, قَالُوا مَا أَخْلَفْنَا مَوْعِدَكَ بِمَلْكِنَا. They said to Musa, we did not break our word to you of our own accord. And that word is that they promised him they will always worship Allah. So they kind of like throwing the blame on somebody else. I.e., we didn't do it out of our own accord. We were pushed into it. ولكن, and now comes the excuse, but حملنا أوزارا من زينة القوم. We were burdened when they were leaving from Egypt. They burdened themselves with loads of the ornaments of the people from the people of Egypt. So they stole them. فقذفناها. A Samari went to them and he said, you know, all the wealth that you stole belongs to the people of Egypt, and you know it's not permitted to do that. Yahovah or Allah will be angry with you, and I need that jewelry, gold, and everything to build this statue that Allah had told me to build for you to worship. So people, without asking questions like so many Muslims today, they don't ask questions about why they believe in what they believe. They don't research. They just follow. Then they said, فَقَذَفْنَا, and we simply threw them down into the fire. A Samari had made a pit, and in that pit he had wood and rocks and everything to, so that he can sculpt this new calf. And why the calf? Well, because in Egypt, the cow and the calf were symbols of gods, and the Egyptians were, the children of Israel were used to the worship of calves. So it was not a monkey, because they are not used to monkeys. The Egyptians didn't worship monkeys, but cows and cats and things like that, they did. So it was some type of usual business for them. They saw cows be worshipped before, they worship now, it's no big deal. And that's what the Samari did. So they said, and then they threw the blame on the Samari. They said, فَكَذَلِكَ أَلْقَى السَّامِرِي, and a Samari as well did throw something. And this is in Surah Taha, again the ayah 87, Surah Taha is number 20, but if you read the whole story, the whole surah, it will give you a good idea. Now Musa alayhi salam is really curious. What is it that a Samari had thrown down into the fire? Because the children of Israel told him that we threw all jewelry. And then they said, and a Samari as well did throw something, but we don't know what he had thrown. And to get that answer, Musa turns to a Samari in person, because something of a great danger was cooking up. Something that a Samari did demolished what Allah and Moses tried to inculcate in the minds of the children of Israel. That is to only worship Allah as the one true God and completely abandon all else. But that plan is failing now. Of course, as far as Allah is concerned, rectifying this matter is only a matter of be and it is, and it will become, and that's that. But that is not how Allah functions with humans. With Allah, it is free will all the way. And he does a lot to help, but it is up to us to decide which way to go. Because on Judgment Day, ain't nobody that's going to turn to Allah and say, it's you who made me do it, or you who suggest that I should do it. On Judgment Day, Allah is going to ask us about the choices and why we made them. Allah and Moses are challenged, and the challenge is real and real serious and big. Allah says and explains about this challenge, and he says, فَأَخْرَجَ لَهُمْ عِجْلًا, and he brought out from the fire a calf, جَسَدًا لَهُ خُوَار, a body, a real tangible body, physical body of a calf, and a body which made calf house sound. You see, in the books of tafsir and all this, who the mechanics of religion, the, who always try to fix things, they say, oh, it was not real sound, it was the wind coming through in and out, and it, because of that, it just made a sound, and people believed it's a calf sound or a cow sound. Allah says it's a real body that also had sounds of cattle, of cows. I don't know these mechanics. Wallahi, I don't know how, why they do all they did. But anyhow, and the worst bit is that they invented a vile claim that has no value whatsoever, and that is only to decorate a lie. And what was that vile thing? Is that فَقَالُوا هَذَا إِلَهُكُمْ وَإِلَهُ مُوسَى. As-Samiri and those with him, they said, this is your God and the God of Moses. Subhanallah. And then Allah says, فَنَسِيَ. And he, As-Samiri, had gone far off the right path when he did what he did. The books of tafsir, they say Fanasiya, it is Musa who had forgotten, all that kind of stuff. But it's not true, because Musa alayhi salam had got pretty good idea who was the perpetrator, and that's why he went straight away to As-Samiri. When he got to As-Samiri, he asked him, Qad, Fama khatbuka ya Samiri? He said, Samiri, what have you got to say about this? Why did you do that? What's your deal about it? Why? As-Samiri now is going to explain to Musa what had happened and what has encouraged him to do what he did. And now we're going to go back to our good friend Jibreel alayhi as-salam. As-Samiri said, قَالَ بَصُرْتُ بِمَا لَمْ يَبْصُرُ بِهِ. He responded, I noticed what they, the children of Israel, did not notice. What did he notice that the children of Israel did not notice? Well, as it turns out, at one point, Jibreel alayhi salam came to the children of Israel, Allah, when Musa did what he did, and he did not follow the commands of Allah to the letter, when he was early to the Median, Allah had sent Jibreel, the giver of life, to test the children of Israel in the most dangerous test ever. Caused Jibreel to give life to something. And that's exactly what happened. When Jibreel came, Allah knows who is the most mischievous of all the children of Israel. Allah commands Jibreel to walk in front of the man who is the most mischievous man of children of Israel, As-Samiri, and let that man see a deed, not Jibreel, but a deed of what Jibreel can do. And then the man took advantage of that, and this is what happened. قال, he said, بَصُرْتُ بِمَا لَمْ يَبْصُرُ بِهِ. I noticed what they did not notice. فَقَبَضْتُ قَبَضَةً مِنْ أَثَرِ الرَّسُولِ. So I grabbed a handful of dust from the prints of the messenger, Jibreel. You see, when Jibreel came, he did not appear fully, but he walked in front of As-Samiri. So As-Samiri could see something walking. The footprint shows, but he sees nothing. As-Samiri, because being of the children of Israel, and always remember, the children of Israel were following the laws of Jacob and Musa, of Yusuf alayhi salam, and then later on Harun and Musa, he knew about Jibreel because it was part of their belief, and knew the abilities and capabilities of Jibreel. So when he saw that, he linked that to Jibreel as the life giver. That's why when he saw that, what he did, as soon as Jibreel walked his footprint on something, anything that Jibreel touches takes life. If Jibreel walks into your sitting room or living room right now and touches your television set, your television set will become alive. If Jibreel touches your car will become alive. He will inject life in it. SubhanAllah, it's incredible, this Jibreel. And that's what As-Samiri did. When he grabbed that handful of dust that had life in it, what did he do? فَنَبَذْتُهَا. And then I cast that hand where? In the pit where the children of Israel had casted their jewelry. And what happened? That, imagine, the gold of the children of Israel, the jewelry, got mixed with the formula of life that Jibril had. What do you think happened? The calf, even though it was not alive, but it was mooing, moo, just like the real calves. And when the children of Israel saw that, they thought that Assemity had created to them a god-like calf, just like the children of in Egypt, and the children of Israel forgot that Allah doesn't do all that kind of stuff. And that's why he says, and that is what my own self tempted me into. Musa alayhi salam retaliated, saying, قال, فذهب, leave us, go out from us, go by yourself, leave the children of Israel. فَإِنَّ لَكَ فِي الْحَيَاةِ أَن تَقُولَ لَا مِسَاسِ. For the rest of your life, you will always be crying to people, no touching, no touching, i.e. nobody's gonna touch you. You're not. What that also means, he can't get married, he can't have a family, he cannot buy from people, he cannot be with people. It's total isolation. And then Musa added, وَإِنَّ لَكَ مَوْعِدًا لَن تُخْلَفَهُ. And you also have an appointment from which you will not be able to escape. And then he told him before he exiled him, وَانْظُرْ إِلَىٰ إِلَٰهِكَ الَّذِي ظَلْتَ عَلَيْهِ عَاكِفًا. Look at the God, at your God, which we have kept on worshipping. لَنُحَرِّقَنَّ. We shall grind it, and we also will burn it and scatter it into the sea, because your ilah innama ilahukum Allah, because your true God is Allah. There is no other deity but Him. Again, this is Surah Taha, the Surah number 20. Again, read the whole story. My dear sisters and my brothers, Jibril and is the spiritual life as well. Just like he can inject life in newborn baby, as I said, if he touches anything, car, rocks, buildings, if he touches anything, that thing there takes the form of life. Jibril alayhi salam is also the one who brings us the revelation from Allah that injects life in us. This is why Allah says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu istajibu lillahi walirrasul. You who have believed, answer to the commands of Allah and to the Messenger, i.e. Al-Quran. And Allah says, إِذَا دَعَاكُمْ لِمَا يُحْيِيكُمْ. When it calls you to that which gives you life. And this is in Surah Luqman, that's Surah number 31. As to the angels that takes our lives, Allah has specifically named him as the angel of death, Malik al-Maut. And that's why Allah says in the Quran, قُلْ يَتَوَفَّاكُمْ مَلَكُ الْمَوْتِ. Say, it is Malik al-Maut, the angel of death, that shall collect your souls. Then it is, and because he has been appointed and put in charge for that duty. You see, Jibril alone injects life, and the angel of death alone collects the soul and is helped, i.e. the angel of death, with other angels. With I lost the term there. My dear sisters and my brothers, Jibril gives life and doesn't take it. It is common belief these days that people of Lot were destroyed by Jibril. And there is a hadith where he carried them in one of his wings and then he went all the way to the sky. That's absolutely untrue. Jibril doesn't punish, did not punish the people of Lot. It is rather the angels that visited Abraham alayhi salam that punished the people of Lot, and it wasn't for their homosexuality only. The people of Lot have committed about 14 major sins. Homosexuality is just one of them, and it wasn't the act that was they got punished for. It was more their attitude towards the act. If someone is homosexual and hides it and keeps it to themselves, it's between them and Allah. It's a mistake, like we all make mistakes, and they can repent from it, they can go, and all that kind of stuff. But it is those homosexuals, again, of the people of Lot, they were chasing kids, they were chasing anybody, and they were having sex orgies with male in clubs, in certain clubs. And when Lot came to them and he was preaching them and told them that this is abominable, that Allah doesn't accept this. They told him, get out of the city. If you are pure people, get out. And it is their arrogance that Allah did not accept from them. At this point here, it's enough about Jibreel alayhi salam, and this is why Jibreel is not an angel. Jibreel is a creation of Allah. He is Ruhullah. He is the spirit of Allah that Allah uses to give life to everybody else. Of course, Jibreel out of himself cannot do anything. If Allah doesn't give him that power, that authority, Jibreel cannot do anything by himself. So instead of worshipping Jibreel, we should worship the God of Jibreel. But it helps to understand how Allah functions so that we also take a good advantage of how Allah does things, and also so that we can maximize our rights to have to receive from Allah what we would like to. One more time, Jibreel alayhi salam is always depicted, always mentioned, completely independent from the angels of Allah. The angels are not created from light. This is for now what you need to know about Jibreel. I'm coming up to the next half an hour, so I stop here and I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that in what I said is good enough for you to help you understand how Allah functions, what Jibreel alayhi salam does, and why he is the Holy Spirit and Jesus and all that kind of story. Again, this is your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa, and if you want to join my group, please do send me a message, 078-7640-8735. I live in England, so it's 0044 for those international ones. If you want to join my group on YouTube, it's Islam Pep Talk, and I encourage you to listen to other talks. And Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.